Is Brainiac, where we laugh in the face of danger and slap the cheeks of fear.
The big science questions on Brainiac tonight. Ginger whingers, are redheads more sensitive to pain than brunettes? Taking down their particulars, is a job interview easier if the panel are naked?
So, Mr. Brown, how do you get the best out of people?
Indestructible objects, are they really? And Brainiac boffin John Tickle really pushes his luck.
Brainiac.
The dog, man's best friend. Well known, of course, for his smell. That's not the aromas he creates, that's the smells he can detect. But also their sense of hearing. Thank you. Now, human beings can hear noises of up to 17,000 hertz. Dogs can detect noises of up to 100,000 hertz. Now, this is called a silent dog whistle. The theory is that human beings can't hear it. Its frequency is too high, but dogs can. Of course, if we can't hear it, how do we know it works?
To find out, we armed one Brainiac with a whistle and let him loose in the park.
The object of this exercise is to see if our canine friends really can hear a silent dog whistle. Supposedly, dogs as far away as 300 metres should be able to hear it. But if these dogs can, they just don't care. Some dogs did, however, stop and have a listen. Or was it just our Brainiac that they found disturbing? They came in all shapes and sizes, but as always, it was the small ones that were most uptight. The owner said this dog doesn't normally bark. Again, it may have been the Brainiac and not the whistle. OK, well, that experiment proved to be a little inconclusive. But what about your dogs at home? If they're outside, go bring them in now, because throughout this show, we're going to be playing high-frequency sounds that you can't hear, but your dog can. So if they start to act a little strange, you know what's doing it. Now, to make this easier, you're going to see this on the screen every time we play the sound. Now, if you haven't got a dog, don't worry, because most household pets will react to this noise, we're told. Give it a go now.
Well, there you go. It works for my dogs, but what about yours? Keep an eye out for the flashing symbol during the show.
Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul.
Does people wishing you good luck actually make a difference? Or can you bring bad luck on yourself?
To find out, first I have to test my luck under normal conditions.
All right, here we go.
I've never played this machine before, so any winnings will all be thanks to Lady Luck and nothing to do with skill.
Super pay rise, I've no idea what that does. Let's have a win. No losers, got to be good news. Gamble. Wow.
Viva, viva Las Vegas!
So far, I've spent £15 and had a return of 13. Well, to see if there's any truth in the rumours about bad luck, I'm going to go out, tempt fate, and then come back and play this machine again and see how my luck has changed.
I'm going to hit my head against the wall.
One mirror, 7 years bad luck. Two mirrors, 14. It's bad luck to walk under a ladder, so it must be really bad luck to walk under four. And as for spilling salt...
I'm not throwing that over either of my shoulders. Now, for good measure, here's some new shoes on the table as well.
Crossing someone on a stairwell is considered bad luck by some, as is stepping on cracks.
And now to top it off... That should do it.
Now, the ultimate test. If there's any truth to superstitions, after what I've just done, luck should be very much against me. And in theory, I should lose heavily.
Viva Las Vegas! Viva Las Vegas! Oh, never. Fruit machines, the easiest way to spend money. I'm just going to hold those two again. Super fast catch, we'll take that. And now the moment of truth. On my left, the pile of winnings before I tempted fate, and on my right, the frankly, quite disappointingly meagre pile of winnings after I tempted fate. So what have we learned from our highly scientific experiment today? I think we have to say, don't mess with Lady Luck.
Anesthesiologists, the people who make sure you don't feel anything when you have an operation, reckon they've discovered something peculiar. They reckon that the ginger-haired folk are less able to withstand pain than the rest of us. But is that true? Or are gingers just whingers? We're going to compare the pain thresholds of a redhead and a non-redhead. So let's meet our two brave contenders. Over here on my left in the red corner, we have Ginger Jeff. Over here on my right in the brunette corner, we have mighty Joe Rowntree. Special moves. Gentlemen, if I can call you into the centre of the ring, please. Can we have a good, clean fight? No punching below the belt, no crying like girls, OK? Back to your corners, please. We'll have seconds out. Round one.
Our fight is a three-round contest. Whoever gives in first loses the round, starting with the very painful head rub. Because we don't want to be here all day, we've picked contenders who are guaranteed to give up easy. Everyone, however, has a unique response to pain. Something that's unbearably painful to one person might be only mildly painful to another. The experiment that was done recently at the University of Louisville, however, turned up unexpected results.
Stop it! Round one goes to Ginger Jeff. The next round is the nipple twisting. So, seconds out, round two.
On your feet. Stand up.
Yeah, you're gonna get it, baby.
Who's your daddy?
You are.
It hurts. Want a bit more, darling?
In the Louisville experiment, electric shocks were given to a sample of people.
Come on, definitely.
It was found that the redheads needed 20% more anaesthetic.
That's painful.
Leap up and down for me.
Than the brunettes, in order to cope with the pain. But why would gingers feel more pain than everyone else?
The second round goes again to the redhead corner and Ginger Jeff. Right, the third and final round is the wedgie. Seconds out, round three.
Up. Turn around.
Scientists believe that the answer involves melanin, the pigment that influences skin and hair color. In redheads, the hormone that produces melanin is faulty, and it's believed to interfere with the parts of the brain that sense pain, making ginger nuts more sensitive.
All right, back off, get off.
Yeah. But not, it seems, in this case.
The unanimous winner, undefeated in all three rounds, Ginger Jeff! Amazing!
So, gingers of the world, you have nothing to fear. It's the brunettes who feel pain like big girlies. Sports drinks. Now, apparently we're told that these things rehydrate your body faster than ordinary drinks. Okay, well, if they get into your body faster, does that mean they can, you know, get out of your body faster? In a race to the loo, will sports drinks leave those ordinary out-of-shape drinks standing?
Three bladders, three genuine members of the public, three pints, lager, water, and a leading sports drink. Once they're in, which will come out first?
On your marks, get set. Drink.
And they're off. The drinks will all go down at the same speed, but then what? While lager passes through the body, it also takes water from your blood on the way. How quickly will it all get to the other end? Our body is 90% water. Will this little extra prove surplus to requirements and open the floodgates? Sports energy drinks replace fluids lost by sweat. So will there be anything left to come out? We'll find out when they take a break after the break. Also after the break, do job seekers perform better if they're interviewed by naked people?
Probably start with school.
And after last orders, is more lager really the answer to cool the afterburn of a spicy kebab?
If your dog's been behaving stranger than normal during the show, that's because every time this comes on the screen, it's sending out a high-pitched frequency. Thank you. That you can't hear, but dogs and other household pets can. So if your dog's not in there watching right now, we're doing it throughout the show, so get it in and we'll see what happens.
Still to come, we play with fire to find out which flame is the fastest. And we do more stupid things with a microwave. First, though, we're testing to see which drink travels fastest along 8 yards of intestine. Three people, they've drunk 3 pints, water, lager, and a sports drink. And now we wait. It's been an hour, and we're expecting a result any time now.
Woo-hoo!
A train journey always makes you want to wee, so we're recreating that effect to move things along.
Woo-hoo!
A little visual and oral stimulation should help too. And a little musical inspiration.
Singing in the rain.
It doesn't take long. Our three guinea pigs will have to go immediately after each other so we can make a valid comparison between the three drinks. All our subjects were empty at the start of the experiment, and the one who can now provide the largest sample has the drink that has travelled the fastest. Moments of careful analysis will then produce the verdict.
We have the results. In third place, sports drink with 250 millilitres. In second place was water with 290 millilitres. And our winner was lager with 680 millilitres. Congratulations.
So a shock result. Sports drinks may be fastest into your body, but lager is the fastest out.
You're watching Brainiac.
And my name is Patrick Mower. I'm one of the Butch members of the cast.
Brainiac.
Which flame burns the fastest? We've laid out 3 30-metre tracks of guttering and put big explosives at the end to try to find out. Each track will be filled with a different flammable liquid and then ignited, which is great for us because Brainiacs, by nature, love playing with fire and making things go bang.
Girl, we couldn't get much higher.
The first liquid to be tested is white spirits. Once the flame reaches the end of the track, it will ignite a fuse, which will in turn set off a big explosion. At that point, we'll stop the clock.
The time to hesitate is through.
So, to become Brainiac's fastest flame, 1 minute 52.17 seconds is the time to beat. Now, who hasn't tried one of these? A flaming Sambuca. Admittedly, it's not normally served in a 30-metre length of guttering, but we've thrown in the coffee beans for authenticity anyway. Sambuca, of course, is often used by show-off bartenders who pour it along the bar and then set fire to it in order to impress the girls. Today, though, it's purely scientific. Mind you, burning rather than drinking the Sambuca was a difficult decision to make for our Brainiacs. Sambuca sets a blistering pace of 1 minute 30.8 seconds. Our Our third and final flame is petrol, the one the smart money is on. Used to power vehicles the world over, created for its ability to combust. Yes, you can see the difference. The petrol is just racing away down the 30-metre track, easily burning off the competition. And in fact, an absolute no contest. So, racing to a big finish. At 19 seconds, petrol officially the fastest flame.
Things that make you go,
Here's one for you. If identical twin brothers married identical twin sisters, would their children be identical?
We tried putting steel wool in a microwave. It was interesting, but it didn't really have that factor. So how about an extra ingredient? Liquid oxygen.
Stop! The following experiment is dangerous for your safety and the protection of those around you. Do not try this at home. No, really, don't.
Liquid oxygen is used as rocket fuel. The microwaves make the steel wool fizzle and burn, and the oxygen ignites. It's highly volatile, and when the heat builds, it explodes. We do these experiments so you don't have to. Do not try this at home. No, really, don't. Pub science, the Brainiac alternative to a bar brawl.
Honestly, you're going to be really amazed. I can stub that fag out on that money without burning it. Just need something to conduct the heat away. I'll use 50p and watch this. You're not really very impressed, are you? All right, what about...
Listen, mate, I told you, not in my pub, all right? Go on, get out of here.
Tin pot science! Come on, get out of here!
Finish me, pain!
Psychology, biology, physiology, oleology. We at Brainiac don't believe in any of that nonsense. We believe in real science, science that matters, like the science of kebabology.
One tasty doner, perfect Friday night nourishment. But after a couple of beers, you always ask for too much spicy sauce. So the big question, once you've eaten it, which drink is best to cool your mouth? Three cool liquids, milk, lager and water, and nine Brainiacs, well, 8.5, willing to sacrifice the lining of their mouths. First, those kebabs. To this already spicy snack, we add one further ingredient. Chili sauce. Very hot. It's made from the habanero pepper and is the spiciest sauce that can be bought on the open market. The Scoville unit measures the relative hotness of spicy food. This sauce has a rating of 250,000. And our Brainiacs now have to eat it.
Please pick up your kebab. Now please bite your kebab.
Hot. Chili contains an alkaloid called capsaicin, which attacks the nerves on the tongue. It binds itself onto the taste buds and thereby causes the pain you feel. It also gives the sensation of heat. It's important not to rush this stage. We must allow the kebab the time it needs to do its work.
Please score the pain.
The Brainiacs now have to score the kebab on the pain it's caused.
It's still stinging me, so I'm going to go for a 10.
My lips are still throbbing, so I think I give it a good 8.
8 in my mouth, 9 on my face.
That's a 10 for me, definitely.
I'd say a 9.
Now for the relief. Each team of three gets a different liquid to drink to neutralise the pain.
Please pick up your drink. Please drink.
Water is many people's liquid of choice. Its very blandness should work to its advantage by massaging the aching taste buds in its neutral flavour. Many adherents of the kebab diet swear by lager. Alcohol, of course, can dull feelings of pain, as any medieval surgeon will tell you. The bookies' favourite, though, is milk. Capsaicin is soluble in fat, and as such, milk should be particularly good at loosening the bonds that tie the chili to the tongue.
Please score the pain you feel now out of 10.
On the outside, my lips, it's quite soothing. Okay.
Still feel that.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Lager's your friend, and although it cooled me down, my lips are still burning.
And here's the verdict.
The result, the best drink to have after a kebab is milk.
All of which leaves the Brainiacs with one more fairly urgent experiment. How to deal with the effect of cheapo kebabs on the digestive system.
I'm Peter Logan, and this is my exploding paste. When it's wet, it's safe, but when it's dry, it's very unstable.
Logan's paste is made using iodine crystals and one other secret chemical. It's so volatile that when dry, even the movement of a small insect can detonate it. Peter Logan first made his exploding paste while at school after concocting a recipe from an old textbook. Way back then, the only use he found for it was practical jokes. Many decades later, nothing has changed.
Dear John, I'm quite sceptical about this, but I've heard it several times. I've even heard Richard Madeley quote it on the telly. The fact states that if you go to the bottom of a well during the day and look up, you can see the stars. Is it true? Cheers, Emma from Norwich. Well, Emma, let's go and see what we can find out. Right then, Emma. Getting to the bottom of a well was just too difficult and dangerous for a big scaredy cat like me. You need breathing apparatus, safety equipment, couldn't be doing with it. So we got the next best thing. A 30-metre-high disused chimney. There's just one small problem. The chimney's all blocked up. It hasn't been used for the best part of 30 years, so if I'm going to get in there and have a look up the top, we've got to clear some of this muck out.
That's the sound of the men working on the chain. Yeah.
I don't know. The lengths I go to sometimes, might as well get a kitchen roll tube and look through that. Right then, I reckon that'll do us. I'm going to take this little baby in there and see what we can see. Oh, balls. Here we go, let's see what we can see. Oh, dear me. Just as I suspected, you can't see a thing.
Clear blue sky, not a dicky bird. Not a star in the sky.
That's the sound of the men working on the chain.
Well, there you go, Emma. Conclusive proof. You can't see stars at the bottom of the well or a tall chimney.
Working on the chain. Yeah.
Fat v thin is a physiological quest to determine whether it's better to be under or overweight when nature throws its elements at you. We've discovered it's better to be overweight if stranded in the sea, as big equals buoyant. But it's better to be bony in a blizzard, as our thin guy stayed the driest. When it comes to handling the heat, our thin guy kept his cool.
Yay!
But was bowled over by the breeze, as we discovered mass matters in a full force gale.
Yeah!
In this week's Fat v Thin, we're going to find out if it's better to be under or overweight if stranded on the North Pole in just your swimwear. The room they'll be sitting in is maintained at a constant 0 degrees Celsius. Both subjects had a body temperature of 36.9 before entering the test area. The first subject's body temperature to drop by 3 degrees will be declared the loser. Their progress will be displayed on a digital readout. While the fat man has more insulation to protect him, he's less fit than the thin guy, who might be better able to regulate his body temperature. We'll return later in the show to see who's hot and who's not. People say that science and art don't mix. We disagree. We think we can make great modern art, industrial amounts, enough to flog for huge sums to fund our lager habit. Leonardo took 4 years to paint the Sistine Chapel, but we haven't got that kind of time. On Brainiac, art is delivered by an air mortar at 80 miles an hour. All good Brainiacs know how to fill a condom. Little bombs of paint. We like to leave our personal mark on our work. So how does it look? Well, like all modern art, crap. But I think we can safely say the biggest Jackson Pollocks are on Brainiac. Jeremy Brown works 9 to 5 at Brownlow and Jones. He gets 4 weeks holiday, as much stationery as he can nick, and he's bored out of his brain.
Good afternoon, help desk.
He'd like to tell his boss to take his rotten job and shove it where the sun doesn't shine. But he's desperate to get a mortgage so he can stop living with his parents. So he can't. That's why Jeremy is going for an interview for a new job.
And that's where we come in, because we're going to give Jeremy some help, a bit of interview practice. And at the same time, he's going to help us with an experiment. Like a lot of people, Jeremy suffers from nerves during interviews, and bad nerves spoil his performance. Now, a lot of people reckon that a good trick to help calm yourself in that situation is to imagine the interviewer naked, and that helps make you less nervous. Well, let's not imagine it. Let's do it.
You dig?
Here they are, the panel he has to face. First, they're going to interview Jeremy fully clothed. Then, they're going to get their kit off. They're going to give him a score on how well he does each time, and we'll see if he managed to perform better the second time when they're less dressed.
OK. They're ready for you.
Welcome, Mr. Brown.
I'm pleased to meet you.
I'd like to take a seat. There's my colleagues.
We're also wiring Jeremy up to a heart monitor to get a reading for each part of the interview. So, best of luck, Jeremy.
Tell us a little bit about yourself, Mr. Brown.
Well, where would you like me to start? I could probably start with the school.
The thinking behind this theory is that if you can imagine your interviewer is naked, then you'll feel that they are more human, as vulnerable as you feel, and therefore that you have nothing to fear from them. It's like if they've got everything on show, they're hardly likely to have a pop at you.
One of my jobs was to source a below-the-line marketing agency for one of their summer campaigns. So far,
Jeremy's heart rate is quite high. He's usually 60, but already he's scaling 98. The nerves are starting to show.
And what sort of salary are you expecting?
I feel as though, you know, my time in the industry has warranted a pay rise. So, You know, I feel that I could be earning something like £21,000.
Well, the panel don't seem to be too impressed so far.
Well, thank you, Mr. Brown. Thanks very much. If you'd just like to go outside and we'll be with you in a little while.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Jeremy's heart rate averaged around 88 beats per minute over that part. But how do the interviewers rate his performance?
Get the feeling that there's that sort of indication of responsibility.
We want the man to do the job. I mean, is he the man? Is he a person can't settle down, you know, and get on with the job?
I did feel that, yeah.
So it's not looking good for Jeremy. But how well will he do in the second half of the interview? Now the clothes are coming off. Will he be less tongue-tied when he gets an eyeful of this lot? Find out after the break. Also to come, fat or thin, which is it best to be if you're stranded at the North Pole? And it's claimed that these things are all indestructible. But are they?
This is Brainiac, the show that puts science in tight underpants and gives it a wedgie. Coming up...
Can a crack team of explosive experts get into the world's toughest safe?
This is pentaerythritetranitrate, burns at 17.5 kilometres a second.
And we give so-called unbreakable objects the Brainiac treatment. But first, Jeremy Brown is having a job interview. He's also testing out a theory for us that you'll be less nervous and perform better in an interview if you can imagine your interviewers have less clothes on. So far, they've been fully dressed, but for the second part, they're going to interview him in their pants. The panel are ready, so how well will Jeremy do now?
Okay. They're ready for you again, sir.
It's important that we get an accurate heart reading for Jeremy at the start of this part of the interview, so we haven't pre-warned him that his interviewers are now disrobed.
Oh, Mr. Brown, would you like to take a seat again there, please?
Yes.
Well, not bad so far. Jeremy seems to be taking this new situation in his stride. However, when his mouth opens, it all starts to unravel.
So, Mr. Brown, how do you get the best out of people?
How do I get the best out of people? How do I get out the best out of people? Right, yeah, in what situation? In a work situation?
Jeremy's heart rate also tells the story. He must calm down soon, or there could be a fatality.
Yeah, I've got to obviously take each individual as their own, and you've got to sort of...
It's not looking good for our theory. It seems that instead of making him more relaxed, he's actually finding it harder to concentrate with so much flesh around.
A bit better.
The mouth opens, but the brain fails to engage.
Yeah, absolutely. I really wouldn't mind that at all.
Would you mind filling in a health form?
Yeah, not at all.
Jeremy should now be feeling empowered, confident and capable. Instead, he appears to have turned into a gibbering mess. He doesn't know where to put himself.
Nice, yeah. If you could just fill the details.
And how much notice would you need to give your present employer if you were offered the position?
Well, contractually, it's one month, but obviously that is negotiable if I get offered the job.
Ah, that's very good, very good. Well, thank you very much for coming in, Mr. Brown.
Well, thank you very much for seeing me.
Appreciated it.
Thank you very much for seeing me, yeah, thank you. Appreciate that. Cheers, hopefully speak to you soon.
Bye. Lovely. Bye.
It's all over. Our readings show that when the interviewers had their kit off, Jeremy's average heart rate was 27% higher than when they were clothed. He also visibly struggled more with bare bodies in front of him.
Okay.
So did the panel think he should get the job?
They're ready for you now.
Time to give him the bad news.
Oh, Mr. Graham.
Hiya.
Take a seat again.
Thank you very much.
Well, after a quite extensive interview, I have to say that the first part of the interview, we scored you 5 out of 10.
Right.
And the second part was 3 out of 10.
Right.
So unfortunately, we won't be able to progress your application further. Thank you very much for coming.
Well, thank you
so
very much for seeing.
Another theory bites the dust.
No, didn't get it.
Naked or clothed, if you're rubbish at being interviewed, you'll always be rubbish. Back to the day job, Jeremy. You loser. Is it better to be fat or thin at the North Pole? To find out, this experiment has been performed under strictly controlled conditions, with the temperature constantly maintained at freezing point. Before the start of this experiment, our two subjects had body temperatures of 36.9. The first person to drop 3 degrees and fall below 34 will be declared the loser. After 25 minutes of chilling out, our 6.5 stone thin guy is really starting to struggle, while our 22 stone fat guy has hardly felt a thing. Thin guy's puny body is frantically trying to raise its temperature by shivering. But it's too little, too late. So in this week's Fat v Thin, it's better to be porky than puny.
We're the Brownlow Boys. That's me, Terry, and this is my boy, Jamie. We've been dealing in safes for 28 years, and this one here is one of the best. So good, in fact, we're putting 200 big ones in it. And if you can crack our safe, the dough's yours. But don't count on getting inside too easy. It's nearly 1 tonne of solid steel. The doors are 5.5 inches thick, and it's been specially designed to resist attack from torches and drills alike.
Our safe started out looking pretty sharp, but all the efforts to get into it have begun to take their toll. This drop hardly made a dent. Fire, petrol-powered angle grinders and sledgehammers roughed it up, but only a little. Two stock cars had a go at it, but the only damage was cosmetic. Not so for one of the cars. The engine was a complete write-off. Former specialised debt collector Dave Courtney and his crew had a go using their tools of the trade, but again, the cash remained securely locked away. This week, it's the turn of our explosives experts.
Today we're going to try and blow a hole through this safe using some of this stuff. This is Primacord. It's got some high explosive compound called pentaerythritetranitrate. Burns at 17.5 kilometres a second. Pretty fast stuff. And we're going to try and attach it to this safe now.
The explosive needs to be wired and rigged up to an ignition system. This enables it to be detonated from a safe distance. The bomb goes on to the weakest part of the safe, the combination lock. The big question is, will something that burns at 17.5 kilometres a second be able to do any damage to the safe?
See where it's actually pulled off the aluminium coating here, and this has just burnt us away, but we're going to need something an awful lot more powerful to get through this 4-inch thick steel here.
So far then, the safe has lived up to its name. But next time, will this Challenger 2 tank, armed with a high explosive squash head shell, finally be able to crack it open?
If you've noticed your dog or cat's ears pricking up more than usual during the show, that's because of our Brainiac experiment.
Every time this symbol appeared, we've been playing a high-frequency sound that only they can hear. So if your pet reacted, we'd like to know. Do drop us a line at info@brainiac.co.uk. That's info@brainiac.co.uk. However, if your cat or dog has crapped on your brand new sofa, it really wasn't our fault.
Hangover. This will do. Relieves acid indigestion. Yeah, but why do they make me fart?
why they make me fart.
From appearances, these two glasses are the same. They're both transparent, they're both lightweight. But look what happens when I drop them. The glass on my right is unbreakable. The glass on my left was very breakable indeed. Most products that are claimed to be unbreakable are made of durable plastics like polycarbonate or super tough metals like titanium. And the reason those materials are so tough is down to their chemical bonds. Their atoms are very difficult to separate, and that makes them extremely tough and difficult to break. Now, here we have a selection of objects that are claimed to be unbreakable in normal everyday use. So we've arranged a little test to find out just how unbreakable they really are. Okay, let them loose! So that's the first test out of the way. Time to see what damage our deranged brainiacs have done to our so-called unbreakable items.
That's had it. That's okay. No. That's all right.
Right then. Well, we'll single out a few of these items for some special treatment. Westlife's unbreakable. I wonder. I think not. This is science. Didn't break. That's no good at all.
So, what to do with what's left?
These items live up to their unbreakable name. But now, for the ultimate challenge, we really are going to sort the men from the boys.
The plan is to place our surviving unbreakables in the caravan with two meteorological balloons filled with a mix of oxygen and propane. It's best to add those later. When ignited, the blast will be massive due to the rapid expansion of the two gases, but there won't be a lot of fire. This will enable us to cleanly examine our objects after the explosion.
That is a military spec Kevlar helmet. It'll protect the head from a high-velocity rifle round. It's pretty tough. That is a stab and bulletproof vest. It can withstand a point-blank shot from a 357 Magnum or a shotgun. Tough stuff, but is it unbreakable?
Well, we're about to find out as we carefully place our mannequin in the caravan, along with our two fully fueled weather balloons. Now, whatever you do, don't blink or you'll miss it. That's what happens when oxygen and propane rapidly expand. The gas has to go somewhere. And as you can see, the caravan goes everywhere.
Right, let's go and see what's left. The caravan's not unbreakable anyway. I'm just looking for bits. Right, let's have a look at our fella and his protective kit. It's rather gruesome. Up you get. How are you doing? Now, stab-proof vest seems to have held up surprisingly well, and the Kevlar helmet, you know, it's not as bad as it looks. I think he might just pull through. Tin plates, they're all right. Oh, look at that. They're bent. That's intact. Right then, out of everything we tested, these are the survivors. I mean, some of them are a bit battered and bent, but, you know, still serviceable. And these glasses, well, they're incredible. Time they were upgraded, in fact, from unbreakable to, I think, truly indestructible.
So there you have it. Not everything in life does what it says on the tin. But then it's not every day someone tries to blow it to bits.